our speaker will discuss the Brighter Brains Institute, a San Francisco Bay nonprofit that promotes humanist principles in Western Uganda. BBI built, and I'm not sure how to pronounce it, BiZoHa, the world's first atheist orphanage. It recently converted four schools in Ruwenzori Mountains to secular humanist principles, and it publishes African humanist writers like Leo Igwe and Bwambale Robert Musubaho. It also established 12 clinics in the region to combat malaria, cholera, HIV, AIDS, and other diseases. Our speaker, Hank Pellissier, is a writer for greatschools.org, program director of the Brighter Brains Institute, and he previously wrote for the New York Times.com, Salon.com. He's authored Brighter Brains, 225 Ways to Elevate or Injure IQ. He produced the world's first atheist film festival in 2009 in San Francisco, and a 2010 Atheist Calendar. Would you please welcome Hank Pellissier?
Testing, testing. Is that good? Everybody hears me fine? Great. Thank you for having me here today. It's really a pleasure to come in and talk to you all about what my organization has been doing. Okay, I'm just going to start right in. Let's see. Humanist outbreak. We've only been in operation for like 2 years, and this question that I have right at the beginning is we've gone from helping one humanist school about 16 months ago, and now we're helping 12 humanist schools. So my point in that statement is that there's an enormous opportunity in Africa to get people interested in humanism. They're very willing to listen to humanist ideas, but I have and there's two reasons why, and those two reasons are what I'm going to say is materialism and feminism. And the materialism will sound a little bit cynical, but you have to like look at it from the sub-Saharan African point of view. And the feminism is a very real is a great reason why African women are interested in humanism. So let me just see if I did I go past one. Let me just see. Okay, wait a sec. There, materialism. I have a master's degree master's degree in humanities with an emphasis on religious studies. So I studied the history of religion in college, and I found it very interesting that in Africa people still approach religion in a way, in the way that we regard as sort of the origins of religion, that they use religion because they're looking for like magic ways to improve their daily life. And the magic that religion promises them is prayer. And of course it doesn't work. But when I go to Africa, so many Ugandans will say things to me like, this morning I prayed for such and such and I hope it happens today. Or I'll tell them something like, my father is very sick, and they'll say, I will pray for your father and he will be well. So The point I'm trying to make about, I think that we think of religion a lot, like the people are based in religion in the United States out of tradition or out of faith, reasons like that. But in Africa, there's still this notion that religion can provide like a magic to make their life better. So, and of course, that's actually not going to work in the long run, because you can pray all you want and you're not going to get what you want. Now, the way that I heard something very interesting when I was there in Uganda the first time, which is I always think that people like stick with a religion and they're really tied to their religion and they fight against other people if they don't belong to the same religion. But my Ugandan friends said that in Uganda that's not the case at all. Their approach to religion is they're looking for magic to make their life better. So they may go to one church for 2 or 3 months, and if their life doesn't get better, they will switch and join another church. And they'll do this over and over and over again. So it's entirely possible in a situation like that that they may join humanism and see if their life gets better. So let's see. And so I had to think about, well, what can humanism promise them? Okay. So the other thing I mentioned was women's rights in Africa. Humanism promotes gender equality. We teach humanism in Uganda based on this book called The Code of Ethics, 10 Humanist Principles. And there's a lot of like women's rights in there. And women's rights are a huge issue in Africa where they're still, women are regarded as second-class citizens in a lot of countries. Their girls are taken out of school early. Wives are beaten. Rape is kind of, you know, is a huge problem. And divorce is kind of uncommon. Women are just expected to stay with their husband, and the husband might get, you know, 2, 3, or 4 more wives. And so there's opportunities. For humanists to go into Africa and say women are equal to men, that can have a huge impact that I'm going to explain a little bit later. Some other things are humanism condemns wife beating, rape, and arranged marriage. Humanism promotes condom use, birth control, women's equity and leadership and economic rights. These things are huge, not just for the individual, but this is like a huge global health problem. As you know, there's been like an AIDS epidemic in sub-Saharan Africa for like 25 years, and a huge responsibility for that AIDS epidemic is that religious people still say that you cannot use condoms. So, you know, the Pope and all these other religious leaders are tremendously responsible for, like, you know, causing, like, you know, millions of deaths. I don't even have it listed here, but as you might know, in Uganda there's tremendous persecution of gays as well. So the gay community in Uganda also has an enormous benefits out of accepting humanism as well. Also, humanism condones divorce. Divorce is fine. A lot of people, because the religions in Uganda, it's basically in Uganda, it's Catholics and Anglicans, primarily Anglicans. They do not condone divorce. So a lot of women are stuck in marriages that they don't want to be in. So one thing we do is we provide Afropads, and Afropads are simply recyclable girls' sanitary pads. That's all they are. And you can wash them, and you can use them over and over again. And these are a tremendous benefit, and all Ugandan girls want them because a lot of them just drop out of school when they start having their period because they don't have any way to, like, keep from having, like, an embarrassing bleeding incident in school, so they just drop out of school. Or say they stay home, and they miss, like, 5 days of school, and then they go back, and they're behind, and so they just drop out. So that's, like, one of our feminist things that we do is just try to provide Afropads to schools that agree to, like, be part of our humanist program. Let's see. And just briefly, as like, what is the Brighter Brains Institute? We're composed of about 30 people now. About half of them are Ugandans, and those are people that we have, you know, over there that we send money to, and they tell us what their communities need. And the rest are here in the United States, and, you know, we're basically the fundraisers and the strategy organizers. And we're a small group. We've probably raised maybe $100,000 in the last year. Our fundraising, we've never gotten any grants. Our fundraising is entirely through these things, like you've probably heard of, like, Kickstarter or GoFundMe or Indiegogo. And by now we have kind of a we have a big email list, so we just send it out to our email list and saying we need money for this and that. And another thing we do is, are a lot of you familiar with Reddit? We do a lot of posting on Reddit/atheism and Reddit/humanism. We have a lot of sponsors from there. And our goal, it's been evolving, but our goal quite clearly now is to establish humanism in Western Uganda. And we've been really successful. I know when I was announced, he said, we have converted 4 schools to humanism. That just went up to 9 in the last 2 weeks, because it started off where I would have to, like, I send this guy $50. He's our humanist ambassador there, and he goes around and he asks schools, do you want to be humanist? Do you want to be humanist? I don't have to do that anymore. I get emails saying, we want to join, we want to be humanist, we want to join you. So it's gone up to 9, and I'm probably going to have to cut it off because our funding can really only help we now have 12 schools that we help, and that's about all our funding can handle. And the last thing I have down here is our inspections, which are totally fun. We just go once a year, and we visit all of these Ugandan schools. And if anybody ever wants to go, just let me know. It's a great time. Last time I went with my brother and his wife, and his son and his daughter-in-law, and we all had a great time. The Ugandans and probably Africans in general are really big on appreciation and hospitality and giving you the, oh, I'm wearing a shirt that they made me. But they're big on, you know, the whole school will do like songs and dances for you, and they'll put on a parade, and it's quite overwhelming. So I want to tell you like how we got involved in it. He mentioned that I grew up Catholic, but I've been an atheist for a long time, but I wasn't any kind of atheist activist until 2009. I got simultaneously upset about two things. One was Pope Benedict criticizing condom use in Africa. I don't know if anybody remembers that. And at the same time, I read Ayaan Hirsi Ali's book, Infidel, which was also like equally infuriating about I got infuriated about religion. Anyway, I decided at that time that I would put on the Atheist Film Festival in San Francisco in 2009, and then in 2010, I put together an Atheist Calendar that was picked up by Atheist Alliance International. And then I got sort of sidetracked into this other movement called transhumanism. I don't know if any of you are familiar with transhumanism, but I've been involved in transhumanism for about 5 years, and I've put on 10 transhumanist conferences and 2 transhumanist debates. But back to how I got involved in Africa is I was kind of amazed. I was just online Googling around stuff, and I found a humanist school in Western Uganda. That's Kasisi Humanist Primary School. In the middle of what appeared to me to be nowhere, there was a humanist school. And it turns out there is a humanist movement before me in Uganda. It was started about 10 years ago by this white guy named Stephen Hurd. There is a Sir Isaac Newton humanist secondary school and a mustard seed humanist school, which is for middle schoolers. And this is a primary school. And it's in Western Uganda, and it turns out it was about an hour away from a person I wanted to visit who was a friend of mine from journalism who had joined the Peace Corps and moved to Uganda. And so I decided that I was going to go to Uganda and visit this village that my friend had stayed in and visit the school. So I went there and I visited Bwambale Robert Musubaho, and I found out all about his school. And it turns out I loved the area. I don't know if you have any, like, magic place from your childhood that you always wanted to go to. But the place I always wanted to go to is called the Ruwenzori Mountains of the Moon. Perhaps you've heard of them. They're on the equator, but they're 16,000 feet high. So there's like glaciers on the equator, these huge mountains, and it's where there's like a lot of gorilla. And it's just this wacky place. And so I decided, well, I've got to go. So lucky for me, because I'm not a completely unselfish person, I wanted to get involved in doing charity work in a place that I also wanted to go to. So this turned out to be like the perfect place for me. And there's even a particular tribe that I work with there. It's called the Bakonzo tribe. And they're the tribe that lives like in the foothills of the Ruwenzori Mountains. And so that's who I primarily interact with. And, I've learned a few, Bakonzo words, and they're kind of a delightful kind of culture. Okay, so this is the first place we got involved with. I decided what my organization was just going to help this particular school. And you can see it's actually a fine-looking school. The guy is pretty brilliant. He, Bwambale decided when he was in college that he was an atheist. He didn't even know what an atheist was. He didn't have any idea. Everybody around him was religious and acting strange, and he decided that there must be an alternative, and so he kind of like looked around on the internet and realized there were people that did not believe in God, and he decided he would become one of them. And it turns out, I mean, he's a pretty amazing guy. He's like, he was an orphan himself, but he learned how to cut hair well, and he made enough money, and he bought like a couple of beauty parlors. And he turns out he's a master internet marketer, and so he has money from all over the world, and he's built this like humanist primary school there. So we help it, and one of the ways we help it is we put in a clinic. This is not actually named after me. I have a brother who is a San Jose Silicon Valley CEO, and he gives a lot of money to the organization, and he is happy as can be to donate money to my organization so that we set up laboratories. So we have 16 clinics now all over. My brother has about 8 of them. There about 8 of them have his name on them. So we have clinics there. One of the things that clinics does is deworming. I don't know if you're familiar with deworming, but it costs like half a cent per child, and it's a way to kill these parasitic worms that reduce the child's ability to learn. It makes them hungry. It makes them weak, and it's very easy to. It's been regarded by people in the charity world as the single best thing you can do with a dollar is to deworm children. And we actually think that deworming is very interesting. You know, my brother and I have read a lot about parasites and how horrible they are. And so we've sent them microscopes and deworming medicine. Okay, and then I have another person in the organization is my brother's son, who is a character I'll probably tell a couple more stories about. His name is Eric. He is a pot grower in the Santa Cruz Mountains. And he has a lot of spare cash, and sometimes he just calls me and says, I have too much spare cash. I'm going to give you some. So anyway, he has set up a creativity lab here. His business is not doing well, and he's no longer funding with us. Another thing that we have given Kasisi Humanist Primary School is shoes and sandals. A lot of these kids do not have any shoes, and it leads to parasitic infections like between the toes and pinworms. And so we like to give them shoes and sandals. And this was another program that we did. This was a sort of complicated campaign we did where we got people to give the organization $15. The $15 was spent hiring a Ugandan tailor to make these dresses that we would give to an orphan. I haven't talked about orphans in Uganda, but the reality is I think something like 22% of all kids are orphans. And you can become an orphan in Uganda in many, many different ways. Two of the most common ways are AIDS. Another way is civil war casualties. We work in western Uganda, which is on the Congo border. And occasionally I think there's some number like 12 or 15 Congo militia groups, occasionally they cross the border into Uganda and they kill people, steal kids as soldiers, steal girls as sex slaves and go back to the Congo. So there is a lot of orphans from these sort of civil disturbances. And there's also a lot of other ways your parents could die. And a lot of times people just give their kids up because they don't have a lot of money. So we fund, I think, 5 different orphanage schools, and we started one orphanage that we'll talk about later. So now the humanism that we practice there, I got it from Bwambale Robert Musubaho and the whole Ugandan humanism movement. There's a particular book, I don't know if it's well known here, and it's kind of bizarre that the Ugandans picked it up. It's a book called The Code of Ethics, 10 Humanist Principles. Has anyone ever seen that book? No one's ever seen it. It's okay that you've never seen it. It's written by a professor at the University of Montreal in Canada. I have the book. It's not very well written, and it's not. But for some reason, the Ugandans have adopted this book as what humanism is. It's a kind of a weird idea. So what I have done is that I have taken this book and I've rewritten it. I'm rewriting it principle by principle. I'm rewriting the 10 humanist principles for the Ugandans, and so that it can kind of understand and so that it's applicable to like African situations. So that's what we do. Out of these 10 humanist principles that you probably can't read, the one that's the most difficult for them is number six. This is the controversial one. This says no superstition. Rely on reason, logic, and science to understand the universe and to solve life's problems. So that's the one that they're in conflict with the religions of Uganda with. One thing I want to say about the education system in Uganda, it's completely dominated by the Anglicans and the Catholics, even the public school system. And the reason for that is that when Uganda got its independence in 1960, it was, of course, terrifically poor, no money for an education system at all. So basically, the government of Uganda said, who wants to run the education program? And the Anglicans and the Catholics said, we will, but we're going to teach the catechism in the public schools. So that's what's going on. So the public school system in Uganda is not secular at all. It's more like a bad religious school. So the schools that we operate in are actually, most of them are private schools. What we look for is private, non-denominational schools. They're usually, by non-denominational, they mean, we're not Anglican and we're not Catholic and we're not Muslim. We just take anybody. And we go in and say, do you want to be humanist? And they say, okay. Oh, but we'll get to like what they get out of that later. Okay. So after we did that, we spent about a year, just funding that Kasisi Humanist Primary School. After that, I was visiting Uganda, and I got it in my head. I said, we should start the first atheist orphanage, because I don't know if you've ever looked up orphanages around the world, but they're overwhelmingly run, I think exclusively run, by fundamentalist religious groups, fundamentalist Christian groups. So the only way you can be an orphan in a Western orphanage is to be like, have the Bible shoved down your throat like all the time. So I said, why don't we start an atheist orphanage? And I have to think like a fundraiser. I'm thinking like, okay, if we start the world's first atheist orphanage, I bet I can get some funding. So it turned out, and I had to kind of talk the guy into it. He's like, he didn't really understand. He goes, well, there's a lot, why orphans? There's a lot of kids. I go, look, we want to make money. I think we can make money having the world's first atheist orphanage. So he finally said, okay, and I had a friend who was a journalist, and he said, what we're going to do is I'm going to write an article promoting it, and you're going to release the campaign simultaneously as my article goes up. So, and he wrote for this hip website called Motherboard Vice, which I guess gets a lot of readership. Anyway, it worked. We decided we were going to try to start with just $5,000, but we raised that in 24 hours, and then I said, well, let's just keep it going. So we got up to about $6,000, and then we said, well, we're starting to look a little greedy, and we cut it off, which I think was the single biggest fundraising mistake of my life. I should have just let it keep going. So, and I think that whole thing worked where we said, do you want to be part of the world's first atheist orphanage? Unfortunately, I can't start the world's second atheist orphanage. That's fundraising, that's not going to work. But anyway, that's how we started. And it took, at the end of about a year, we've raised, I think about $50,000 for that world's first atheist orphanage. And we got some help from Reddit. And it took about a year to build the school. It started off as just what we call a hostel, which has the orphans in it. And then we realized that we were getting enough funding so that we could start a school. There's a lot of orphanage schools in Uganda. Orphans are regarded as sort of second-class citizens. Kids kind of pity them, and the community is kind of like they're not very accepting of them. And the reality is, the orphans in Uganda have, they have a lower lifespan. They're very apt, like a huge percentage of the orphan girls go into prostitution. A huge percentage of the boys go into crime. And it's just not a good life to be an orphan in Uganda. So there's a lot of orphanage schools, which is just for them. So we decided to create a whole school for them, and which meant like building like 15 buildings, one for each grade, plus a dining room and a kitchen, and then we have a roadside stand, and then we have a clinic. So Anyway, so I'm going to show you some pictures of that. We now have about 175 pupils at that school. Here's the orphan girls. They live in, like, you know, there's like two per bed, so this is actually a room for eight. They're pretty darn happy. They're pretty great kids. So that's the orphans, the orphan girls' room. This is the school itself. And we have a fundraiser who just collects books through something called Scholastic Books, and she's been very effective at getting thousands of books to these Ugandan kids. I have some problems with it because I'm just not sure. You know, if you send some kid, a Ugandan kid, a book called, you know, like a, what is it called? Thomas the Train or something. They're looking at like white kids in trains. They've never seen either. So I think we might do better just to give them money and tell them to buy Ugandan books. So although we have an enormous amount of success getting the Scholastic thing, we bought this guy a tractor, which I think was, I haven't decided if it's the single biggest mistake we ever did. There's kind of a belief out there in fundraising. It's kind of like a progressive belief that I don't particularly ascribe to, which they say, just give people money and trust that they'll spend it on the best thing for them. So we had a funder who came to me and said, I have $7,000, I want to give it to your organization, but I want to just give it to Bwambale Robert Musubaho, and he can buy whatever he wants with it. So he bought a shiny red tractor, so which could have built seven buildings and you know, fed kids for a couple of years. But anyway, so he's got a tractor. Supposedly he's going to like invest it wisely. We have urged him to do that. Here's our Afropads. The girls look simultaneously delighted and embarrassed to have their Afropads. But that's been a huge success, and we're very... I'm just going to go forward here. I hit something wrong. Okay, so I want to tell you what happened next. Oh, I already told you all about that. So next, because that was doing so well... And with that one, we didn't bother too much about teaching the humanism, because it's already through Robert Bwambale Robert Musubaho. He's already teaching his humanism. So we didn't have to worry about how we're going to teach it. He's already been teaching it through the Kasisi Humanist Primary School. So we didn't have to worry about it. All Kahandero is we decided we needed a nursery school to go with the orphanage school. So there's a little village near the BiZoHa orphanage school, and we decided we were just going to develop a humanist nursery school there. The biggest part of this, like, you're wondering, how do you teach like little kids humanism? I mean, you can do it. They can't read yet or anything, but a lot of it is just getting their families involved in it. And the single most important thing that we have going on at this place is the clinic. The clinics are probably the most important thing about humanism in Africa, in my opinion. And the reason for that is simply saying, like, the obstacle to condom use in Africa is religion, right? So if you can get people to stop believing in religion, they will use condoms. As soon as they can start using condoms, you're going to get a reduction in AIDS, which is fabulous, and you're also going to get a reduction in the fertility rate, because Africa has by far the highest fertility rate. Uganda has gone from having 4 million people in 1960 to having 35 million people today. And I don't know if you've heard this, but Africa is supposed to have more than half the world's people by the year 2100, okay? They're in no way equipped to handle this, okay? That you cannot have Sub-Saharan Africa is basically a subsistence farmers. You can't have whatever it's going to be, 6 billion people on tiny little farm plots in global warming. It's going to be a global catastrophe. So anyway, back to this one place. This is a thoroughly wretched, it's the most wretched place in Uganda that I've ever been to. I actually took my brother and his family there and said, do you guys want to like help fund a school here in Kahandero? And they said, no, this place is so awful. We should just get some tractors and push the whole town into the lake. And that is because the lake communities or fishing communities. Fishing is fast money. It may not seem that fast, but it's faster than growing like potatoes. So the fishermen can go out in their boats, they can come back with some fish, they can sell it to these city merchants, and then they can spend the money on alcohol, drugs, and prostitutes. And they do. And there's actually like a really high rate of hard drugs in Cajandero, and a really high rate in child prostitution. And I'm talking like 11 and 12 year old girls. So it's a completely seedy place, and we're trying to fix it up. And let's see. Here's just some Cajandero boys. There's an enormous amount of child neglect when you drive into Cajandero. Now, see, the rest of Uganda is not like this. You know, it's got good family structures. People take care of their kids. But in Cajandero, it's not so good. You just kind of drive into town and these, like, kind of rogue, unwashed kids, like, kind of chase you. And you get out of your car and they come up and they poke you. Anyway, it's a pretty... Anyway... Moving on from that, this is kind of what we do with the money. They can put up a house, they can put up a building in about a month. I wire them money for about $1,000. They can build a classroom that'll hold 60 kids. So they just kind of, you don't have to go through permits or any inspections or anything. You just have to get a big truck and you bring in a bunch of bricks. So here they go, and they just kind of build it. And this is the clinic. Most of Cajandero, for some reason, is funded by Londoners. Some people, there's a hospital in London that has some nurses, and they've given us enough money for the clinic and for some of the buildings. And that school, I missed it, but let's see if I can go back. There it is. That school just opened like 2 weeks ago. So we got that nursery school going on there. Okay, so next. After that, I thought that was kind of a fun year because we raised like $70,000 to start two schools. But I know the economics of Uganda well enough to know that raising $70,000 to take care of 200 kids is bad. That's not very good. You don't need that much money to take care of 200 kids, because that's... Well, the reason it cost so much is that we had to entirely build these schools. We were thinking, we want to start some humanist schools, so we're going to build them. Okay? We're going to build the schools. Then I thought, what if we could just go to these schools that are already there and say, do you want to, you know, I use the word convert in an ironic sense. Do you want to convert to humanism? Yes. And I say, and what that means is that you have to teach your students the 10 humanist principles that we will write and we'll send to you, and you have to like read them to the kids there, and you also have to no priests on campus, no religious people on the board. You know, religion is out. We can't have that. Okay, those people are gone. Okay, you're gonna like take orders from us. You're gonna be humanist. And you also have to put up a sign that says that you're a humanist school. And what we'll do for you is that you'll be part of our group. You know, we'll send you, we'll give you a clinic, we'll try to raise money for Afropads and for food and for school buildings. You'll be part of our community of humanists. So basically, this goes back to that early thing I said, which is for a Ugandan to choose a religion, they're not thinking the only thing they're thinking of is, when I choose a religion, I want to get something out of it, financially. I want to get something out of it that provides a better life for my kids. So we're saying, if you choose humanism, well, there's two things back, but if you choose humanism, you will get something immediately better for your kids, because at the humanist school that you send your kid to, you will have the only clinic in town. You know, you will have books that we will send you. You will have shoes and sandals, because we're like humanists, and we're gonna. And part of us being humanists is being humanitarians. And I tell them in emails. Tell them if they don't want to join us, they're fine to be Catholics, fine to be Anglicans. They can find Anglicans and Catholics who will help them. But the reality is, there isn't a lot of Anglican and Catholic help. You know, at these towns that we work in. They're not, you know, these Anglican schools. I don't have them here, but we went and looked at these Anglican schools. They were a wreck. The houses were made out of The school classrooms were made out of branches and mud. They're like completely a mess. So they're looking, you know, they don't know the whole world, but they know that it seems like today, if I decided to be humanist, my kid will have a better education. And the other thing that I mentioned is that if you have girls, if you're a Ugandan mother with girls, you want them to be humanist, because that those humanists are going to tell you that your girl is equal to boys. These humanists will tell the girls that they can marry whoever they want, they have a right to decide how many kids they want, this sort of thing. So. But I'm going to get to the feminist part later. So anyway, I decided that we were going to try to convert some schools. Now, we already had a bunch of schools that we were helping, because we didn't start off as entirely humanist. We started off as, we're just going to help, okay? So it turns out that we were helping a lot of sort of non-denominational private schools already. By private, I don't want you to think they're $40,000 a year private schools. They're private schools meaning that you have to pay like $29 a year to send your kid there. And a lot of Ugandans send their kids to private schools because the difference is the private schools only have 60 kids in a class and the public schools might have 120. So if you have any money at all, you try to send your kids to these private schools. So anyway, I started approaching our private schools, and I was told that the four of them were willing to become humanists. So this is Vision Care Humanist School. It has about 250 kids. And we said right away, I got humanist funders interested right away. This one is, I have a doctor, and he is paid for four classrooms. So he said right away, I will give you money to build a classroom. So these are the kids gathering the bricks to build the classroom. It's really kind of adorable. All over Uganda, every school has a uniform, and they wear the uniform 7 days a week. So when you wander around these towns, you're all like, oh, it's Vision Care School, St. Luke's School. Oh, look at that over there. That's a Mugeti kid talking to a Rays of Light kid, you know, that kind of thing. So anyway, we built a building there. This is the doctor. He paid for the classroom. And we got them food. The food is kind of a heartbreaking situation. A lot of Ugandan kids eat one meal a day. They eat dinner. So they get up and they go to school and they didn't have any breakfast and they're hungry. And then lunchtime rolls around and they're really hungry. And most of these teachers will say, you know, it's hard to teach in the afternoon. These kids are too hungry. And some of the kids just decide they're just gonna leave school. They're just gonna run around and, you know, try to find some food. So it's a great deal for us to offer lunch food. And actually, just offering lunch food, kids will go to school. It's like, hey, there's food at school. I'm gonna go. It's pretty pathetic. We hiked around into those mountains, and we went to some schools where there were like 15 kids, and we'd say, how many kids are in this school? And they go, 100, but you know, 15 today. So the kids just won't show up. So anyway, that food is an important thing we offer. Another one we help is the Rays of Light Humanist Orphanage School. We've had a couple of little problems with them. That's one I'm having difficulties with because they say we want to be humanist. I get emails back saying we want to be humanist, and then I got another email from another guy who says we want to be humanist. But our priest has to read over your principles to see if they need to be rewritten. And I'm like, no, 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 no. And then another guy writes and goes, we don't want to be humanist, we're Catholic. And then I get another email saying, ignore him, we kicked him out of the board, you know? And then the guy writes back and says, take it off your website, we're not humanists. And they're like writing back going, don't answer his emails, we kicked him out, he's not one of ours. So Well, there's two out of the 12 that have been difficult, but that's one of them. I don't know why that guy is not a humanist. I have no idea. There is a problem. I know that they want to be humanists so bad. One of the problems is, I said, I have $1,000 for you to build a new classroom. And they all said, unfortunately, we rent from the Anglicans. They won't let us build a classroom here. But don't spend that money anywhere else. We're renting another place. so that we can put up, you know, a humanist classroom. And I said, okay, I'll hang on to the money. So that's a little, yeah, it's as close to a religious war as I've caused, you know. We also do orphan sponsorship. This is a boy at Rays of Light Orphanage. Now, the amount of the different ways that people die there are just amazing. Sometimes people die in fires. Sometimes they die in floods. Sometimes they die, rocks fall on them. Poisonous snakes is another. Sometimes it's just murder. This guy's an orphan. I don't know what happened to his mom, but his dad was killed. His dad was a poacher, and his dad was shot by the government. So he's now an orphan. Some guys, there's also kids whose parents, who have had parents killed by either crocodiles or hippopotamuses. So here's another school, Mugeti Junior Humanist School. All we're doing for them is building them a classroom. For some reason, a lot of humanists go, one of my parents just died, you know, I inherited some money, we want to build them a classroom. So that's a really common thing. I think it's about 50% of our classrooms are in honor of somebody who has passed away. Okay, so this starts a whole new trend. Those three converted, but the next six I'm going to show you are all women's collectives. They're all people that all women's groups that contacted me saying, we want to be humanist, you know. And I'll say, why do you want to be humanist? And they'll say, because you promote women's equality. That's enough. That's enough. And there's no talk about God or anything. It's just like, you promote girls' equality, we want to be humanist. So this is a whole women's collective in this fabulous place. This is our new favorite group of humanists there. And it's women. And they live in this beautiful place. You can kind of see it's way up in the mountains. They're poor as can be, just horrifically poor. Sort of the more remote you get, the poorer you are. This is their present classroom. I don't know if anybody studies ancient architecture. There's a thing called daub and wattle. When you actually see it, you're just like, oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. It's just interwoven sticks with mud. And of course, they call them temporary houses, and that's because they only last until there's like a couple of big rains, and then they're gone. So that's their classroom, and they were sticking 120 in that room. But we kind of cause our own problems, because as soon as you go into a school and they say, well, we have 120 kids here, and we say, we're going to give you a clinic, and we're going to give you a little bit of food. And then they get an email going, we now have 220 kids, and we need another classroom. So that's what's going on at this place. This is the kind of sign I like, you know, that you can see it says humanist over there. And they're all just kind of sitting there, happy as can be. This is another thing we did for them. We put in a, this kind of cracked me up. They needed water, because all the kids had, there's no clean water in the town. There's just like still water. The kids have diarrhea. The parents have to walk 3 miles to get water and 3 miles back carrying these big giant yellow things. So I said, well, if you give us $3,000, we can bring in a pipe. And so I didn't really think about how this works, but I got the money for them. I sent it to them. What they did was they dug a ditch for 3 miles. So this is their ditch. They dug it for 3 miles up the side of the mountain. They had 3 miles of pipe. And now they have water, happy as can be. There's a water faucet in town. And the water faucet ends at the school. And they're thanking the sponsor, who's a guy from Montreal. And this is their classroom. This is a humanist from Australia. She's building them a classroom. And what else? Oh, this is a guy who came out of nowhere. I get this email. He goes, I am a humanist. I have decided that I am a humanist, and I want to be a humanist teacher. So this guy is not only a convert, he's like a proselytizer. So we now send him money, and he's like the humanist teacher at this Mother Giver school. He's kind of in it for the money. He's like, humanism is the new... It's working. It seems to be working in Buhanga. I'm going to become the humanist teacher. This is a little bit sad here. So I put a lot of work into writing these humanist principles. So I wrote these humanist principles. And the humanist principles are all full of good things. What it means to be a humanist. A lot of it is stuff, It's stuff that they don't get taught ordinarily. It's stuff don't hate people just because they belong to a different tribe. We don't read about it in U.S. newspapers, but there's an enormous amount of tribal warfare still going on. So they hear about, I put stuff like that in the principles. Or I put in stuff like, don't pollute water downstream, you know, that kind of stuff. Don't pollute the river because it'll flow downstream and damage your neighbor. And this is like, you know, it's like, these are like important things, but they don't, their own. It may not be part of their code. They may belong to a tribe that says you must hate the Bayankolo, and it's okay to pollute the river if the person down the stream is a Bayankolo. You know, that kind of thing. But anyway, so he is reading now. He's reading the principles, and this was kind of interesting, but disheartening. He's reading the principles, and you can see people look bored to death. They're bored to death by the principles, and here they are. These are the actual Buhango's women collectors. He has just the saddest look on their face. And so he sends me these pictures, and I'm like, oh, these people look miserable. Do they hate the principles? And then I said, did you do what I asked, which is after you read the principles, do you ask people if they have any questions? And he said, yes. Let me see if I got this. And he said, the kids only had two questions: when will you come to visit, and when will you send us food? So they do have a very pragmatic attitude towards humanism or any other like belief system, and they want food. So since then, we've decided, we sent them food. I got another nice Canadian humanist who was actually, she gave them $2,500 so they could eat lunch every day. They even get goat meat. Anyway, so I'm going to move along quickly because we're running out of time. This is another women's group, Kayenzi Women's Group, another women's collective. They contacted us, and I just have one picture of them, and I don't remember we're giving them a clinic, too. We're giving them a clinic. He's I don't see him on your board, but he is a African-American humanist. So I'm trying to name the clinics after African-American humanists so that they can have, like, black role models. Next one is another orphanage humanist school. We're giving them, I'm not sure what we're giving them. We'll just go on to the next one here. This is another women's collective, Matumo Women's Dignity Foundation. The number one thing, I think I have it on this next page, they want to end wife beating. That's like their main goal. So they're completely excited about our sort of humanist feminist agenda, and they want to join us. And they have an all-girls school called Mojito, and I'm going to put a clinic there. Does anybody remember who Jocelyn Elders was? Yeah. Good for you. And what is she famous for? Surgeon General. And why was she fired?
Okay.
Yes, that is right. She was hired to be the Surgeon General because she was she promoted sex education. And anyway, she's exactly the kind of person I want at an all-girls, to represent an all-girls, represent a clinic at an all-girls school. And she's still alive, so I'm going to try to talk to her. We're going to get a better sign than that one. And this is what the school looks like. These are the Bakonzo. Bakonzo girls don't have any hair. You get kind of used to it. They just don't have any hair. I don't totally know why. I heard that it's regarded as a status symbol, and they don't want to deal with it. So you got to keep your hair short. So, and they're short. I went to Africa expecting to be short, and I was a giant. And the Bakonzo tribe is all about, they're about this tall. And the leader, the person I work with, who's sort of the chief, he's 4'10". He's a very short little African guy. And then this is our last group. They just contacted me about 4 days ago. They've been vague for a long time, saying we're non-denominational Christian. But I think they got wind of, you know, what was going on, and they decided, actually it was a split. Like there kind of is in lots of parts of the world. The men in this organization are not too sure about humanism. You can understand why. But this organization is run by the widows. There's a widows collective. And they said, we want to be humanist. So we got them on board. And this, you can see they have, I want to tell you, this is their previous good house. That's when they had a really good schoolhouse. Anyway, it got wiped out by the rains, and this is their present schoolhouse, which is nothing but some sticks with like some tarps on top of it. Okay, they don't have anything. But since they contacted us, they started making their own bricks, which is our requirement. We say we're not going to build you a clubhouse, a classroom, until you show us that you have bricks. Because they can make their own bricks. They can get the whole community together and make their own bricks. And now they have a big pile of bricks. Okay, so they can have a school. Okay, so conclusion. It is simple to spread humanist ideas if you provide material benefits and appeal to women's rights organizations. Religions can be eliminated because they don't work in Africa at creating a better present life. In fact, the reasons that religion doesn't work in Africa are really quite huge and horrible. Like religion is anti-condom, anti-birth control. And so these are terrible things. And humanism does work both because of its progressive values and because in my organization we provide material benefits. I think that's it. Okay. So we have some time for questions. Thank you.
Okay. I'll bring the mic around. Turn the gain up a little bit here.
Yeah.
Weak.
I realized after I put this together there were so many things that I didn't talk about, but we'll just see if you have questions on those topics. Go ahead.
Yes.
What?
The ten? The ten principles, just something on the
screen. Oh, I would have to find that.
Oh, never mind then.
Yeah, that would be hard to find. Yeah.
I have a question and a comment.
Okay, go ahead.
And I'm thinking of the ability to spread this concept through more of Africa than Western Uganda.
Mm-hmm.
I volunteered in Kenya about 4 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
I volunteered at a school and a hospital, and we were told that it is the law in Kenya that in all schools, including public schools and private schools, religion must be taught. And it depends upon where the location. In one location, it has to be Christianity of some sort. And in the other part, it has to be Islam. So how are you going to surmount that kind of thing if it's legally set?
That's a really good question. And it's a question that the first school that we helped deal with, the first school we helped, Kasisi Humanist Primary School, he was faced with that question. He negotiated with the Ugandan officials, and he does teach a religion class there, but it's called world religions. So it's telling people about different religions that exist in the world. So what the class actually does is teach tolerance of other faiths, which is completely different than proselytizing. So he managed to get it changed from the kids being forced to learn like sort of the catechism or the Bible to the kids getting a broad general knowledge of what religion is. And at his school, they learn part of the belief systems that they learn about when they learn about religion is they learn about humanism as well. So he is not allowed just to teach a humanism class, but he's allowed to teach world religions and say these are what various people believe, and humanism is one thing that you can believe, and now you can have a choice. Okay, I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, okay. Requires a little skill, but
yes, my question. Believe me, he's a really good negotiator. I have to negotiate with him all the time. That's how he got a tractor. Okay, go ahead.
No, I have the mic. The rule is whoever has the mic gets to talk.
Okay, go ahead.
Arthur Jackson is my name. I'm just amazed that this is all the people we have. To me, this is humanism in action. I've never heard of you before, but you're the greatest humanist I've ever met, and I really hope we can get something going here because what you're doing is critically important.
Thank you. Go ahead. She's back there with her hand.
I have to bring them the mic.
Okay.
Hi. This is related to the first question, I think, but not maybe not quite the same.
Uh-huh.
I'm just wondering, it does seem as if the humanist schools and the acceptance of humanism are as you said, a lot because it's more, you know, it's really beneficial and very practical ways for people. Mm-hmm. Aside from the women feminists mm-hmm. who seem very, you know, enthralled with the idea, very convinced.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering, what's your impression of how much the people, not just the kids, and not even just the teachers, but, you know, the society in general, is really at all taken with humanist ideas or even cares about them, versus how much they're really just wanting to hang on to the Christian ideas, or maybe, I don't know if they're animist or whatever other things or, you know, what other religious or beliefs are going on. It
yeah.
seems to me it would be very difficult to really convert people to humanism because it's kind of more nebulous in a way. You know, it's like there's not ritual and all those kinds of things.
Right,
so.
Right. I think I lost my headset, but I'll just talk a little louder. It looks like a hat now. The motto at that first one, Kasisi Humanist Primary School, the motto that there is something like, through science we can benefit. So there is that. There is a belief that, you know, that humanism isn't just abandoning all belief systems. It is using science as the new belief system and rational thinking. And rational thinking there is you know, it's kind of a new idea. Or illiterate. Most knowledge is just it's sort of based on just anecdotal stuff. I mean, there's like, I don't know if you read a lot about Africa, but they believe in some really appalling things. I'm not even going to mention them because they're just like so absolutely appalling. There's a lot of cures for AIDS that you might have heard of. One of them is having sex with pygmy women. And so, and that has been so prevalent that the average height of pygmies is going up like that. And there's all kinds of like just horrendous beliefs about, how to cure AIDS. It's like really appalling. Just Google it. It's too horrible for me to talk about. I don't know if I answered your question at all. There's a lot of different things going on simultaneously in Africa. I did post an essay on my blog saying some Nigerian believes that Christianity and Islam should both be abandoned in favor of traditional African religions, okay? And that's kind of like an anti-colonialist, anti-imperialist idea. Like, by taking on Christianity and Islam, we are sacrificing our whatever, indigenous African culture. So there's a strain if people believe that, but then I have this Nigerian humanist writer, and he's like, that's a terrible idea. It's better to be Islamic or Christian than traditional African, because those people are absolutely crazy. That's like traditional witchcraft, and those are the people who believe things like, I don't know if you read about this, they believe things like you can do magic with dead albino body parts, things like this, or dead hunchback body parts. I don't know if you've read about it, but there's a Christianity is actually horrible in Africa. You know, it's totally fundamentalist in ways that Americans would never ever try. Like you can Google witch child Africa if you want, but there's an enormous amount of money being made by these Christian ministers who say crops failed this year because there are witches in our community, and the witches are, and they'll point to like kids in the parish, and then those kids will be tortured, burned, things like this. There's entire witch camps set up in Ghana and Nigeria, and there's a witch child foundation who I tried to interact with, where there's these like mutilated kids who are accused of being witches. I think I might be straying off topic. Yeah. So this is kind of bizarre, but. And most people don't know it, but there are 60 tribes in Uganda and 60 different languages. and the tribes don't like each other, and the most I can hope to do is work with one tribe at a time, okay? So if I can make any progress with the Bakonzo, that would be great. And then I've started to make a little progress with this other tribe called the Kabila, you know. But there's a lot of different tribes, and the tribes are all, you know, they all have their own different, like, belief systems, and some of them are going to convert to humanism easier than others. The Bakonzo are a very independent tribe. They're a tribe that was persecuted by other tribes for a long time, and they actually adopted Anglicanism, but they, under one condition. The Bakonzo say, we will be Anglican, but all the Anglican ministers have to be Bakonzo. So you can see that they and if you go to the Bakonzo area, like, we would hike around up in the hills, the mountains around there, and we'd come to these villages, and they would have like a Bakonzo flag, and there's actually a called a Kingdom of the Ruwenzori, which is the Bakonzo kingdom. So anyway, it's very complicated, but I think humanism can work sort of tribe by tribe, perhaps, okay? But also, aside from that, there are of course, lots of intellectuals in Africa that are humanist. You know, they don't, they're not particularly well known, they don't get heard from a lot, but they do exist. Okay, I'll take another question.
You said you knew a few Ugandan words, and you're rewriting the humanist.
Oh, I'm not rewriting it in Bakonzo.
No, is there a language barrier? That was one question, and the other one was, is it embarrassing to be killed by a hippopotamus? I can't quite figure out how that would happen. They're kind of slow moving.
Hippopotamuses kill more people in Africa than all other predators combined. And they kill them in the lakes. You know, Kahandero is on Lake George, and we flew over Lake George on the way in to Kasisi, and you can look down, you can see these huge floating things, hippopotamuses, and I'm sure they can just come up to a canoe and scrunch it and just, like, wipe it out. And so hippopotamuses are very dangerous. I think it's their temperament. They're, like, nasty animals. The language barrier. English is the official language of Uganda. So educated people do speak English. When I go, you know, I get email all day long from Ugandans. It's in terrible English, but I can make it out. It's actually quite entertaining and comical, and one of the fun things, because the Ugandan English is formal British with horrific grammar and a total willingness to try out what they think is American slang. So it's really quite enjoyable to try to read it. Okay, any other questions?
I've got one, so I'll ask it, and then maybe that's getting close to the last question. So my thought was, well, if all they want is food, which it appears as though is really important, how come the Christians aren't providing it? Just curious.
I think there's too many. I think there's too many people for all the Christians to feed. I know that there's, because when I get on a plane to go over there, there's me, and then there's this, all these mission groups. You know what I mean? They're all going over there, and they're serving like some community somewhere. But there could be too many, or I don't know. When my organization started, we had multiple religious people involved. I still have a Lutheran professor on my board, and I have a pastor from the Church of Christ in Canada on my board, and I had some Mormons on my board. And but they don't all give, you know what I mean? And they have churches, and they give to their churches, and yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I'm sure the Catholic Church could do a whole lot more than they're doing. Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay, a quick explanation and then a question. Wattle and daub, or daub and wattle, is what's inside the plaster of an English house, half-timbered house.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned Canada, but I was going to ask about this anyway. There's a guy who sells photographs online And the proceeds, a Canadian guy who does this, the proceeds go to help children whose parents have died of AIDS. Have you seen any of that money coming in from Grant Faint? It was really a wonderful thing. I bought a couple of photos because I thought it was such a great photos and such a good cause.
That's an interesting idea. But I haven't come across that. So he's selling like original photos?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Interesting. I mean, I have tons of those photos of kids who's, you know, they're not very good photos, but I have a lot of those photos. But yeah, go ahead.
Question about the teachers. How do you find teachers? What qualifications do they have? How do they acquire their qualifications? The ability to teach?
Uh-huh. That's a really, really good question. And one of the things, I don't think I put it in there. One of the things I get told all the time to fund is increasing teacher salaries, because they have a really hard time keeping good teachers and finding good teachers because the salary is so low. And then there's a big problem in Africa of teachers like not showing up, or teachers quitting without a moment's notice, you know, just like leaving. So what I'm doing in Chirumba, which is where most of the new schools are, is there's the village chief guy. His name is Joseph Kasabarihi. I have him deliver the lectures, okay? He just goes in and does it. Everybody listens to him because he's the chief, and he's also an amazing public speaker. He's very charismatic, and everybody will listen to him. So I just have him do it. Now, is he a humanist? He's the most pragmatic person I've ever met. He will be whatever you want him to be, is what he is. He sends his kids to a Catholic school, but he has three wives, and the Catholics don't like him. They call him a Muslim because he has three wives. And he's also, you know, for now, he's one of our humanist representatives. At the other schools, at some of the other schools, at the women-run schools, I just have like the director of the women's cooperative. She delivers this. So because there's respect in her, I'm hoping that these messages get across. But I do think it's unfortunate. When they were talking about what to fund, I think if I asked all the kids at a school, what do you want me to fund? And they would say food. And then they would say soccer balls. And then they would say musical instruments. And if I asked all the teachers, they would say teacher salaries. And if I asked the administration, they would say new school buildings, okay? So it sort of depends. It's kind of hard to say. And if I ask the girls, they're going to say Afropads. So so we just try to do, you know, whatever we can. Actually, I fund whatever I can get money for, you know, because we don't really have any money. We just have, like, an email list. So I'll say, these are the options this month. Do you want to send us money for this, 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 and this? In the last month, I got most of the money for orphan sponsorship, because people always are like into doing that. And I got some money for medical clinics. I can usually get money for medicine. So the reality is I raise money for whatever people want to give me money for. Yeah, okay.
Okay, I guess I was going to have one more question, but I think we have to wrap it up. Let's give a hand to our speaker again.
Thank you.